Welcome to the weekly webcast. Each week, these messages are brought to you with practical help for daily living from our teacher and pastor, John S. Torell. Our hope is that you'll be encouraged and challenged by this message and that you'll share it with a friend. The parable of the 10 virgins is one of the most familiar stories of the New Testament. The problem is that most Christians are ignorant of marriage customs 2 millennia ago. Dating as we know it did not exist back then. Marriages were arranged and the groom set the wedding day. It was up to the bride and the rest of the guests to be ready during a particular 24-hour period. The 10 virgins waiting to attend the wedding represent 2 groups of people. Knowing the background of Hebrew marriages will open your understanding to the parable and the significance of the oil. Now, let's join Pastor John as he begins today's message.
Well, praise the Lord and welcome to Resurrection Life of Jesus Church Worldwide. And I'm glad to have you here today. We're going to be talking about the 10 virgins. And it's a great story that Jesus had, has great information for us. And before we get into the message, I'm going to pray right now. My Heavenly Father, I'm going to thank you, praise you right now, for anointing me, Lord, as I present this message, that Father God, people will understand it, they will begin to apply it, and they will begin to be living powerful and walking in victory. In Jesus' name, amen and amen. Let's turn to Luke chapter 1 as we start out this message. That's the Gospel of Luke chapter 1. And we're going to go to verse number 27. So I'm going to be talking about marriage. And you have this on the outline. Most Christians do not understand the parable of the 10 virgins because they try and make the marriage story conform with the way weddings are conducted today in America and also in Europe. The marriages we do here are totally different from the way it was done during the time of Jesus. Young adults did not date at the time of Jesus. Did you know that? Young men and women didn't go on a date. Marriages were arranged by parents when children were young. This is what took place with Joseph and Mary. The parents of Joseph examined Mary's family and thought that a union of their children would be suitable. So what they did was they would look upon each other, the families, and said, you want to have a good marriage? Is this a good family? And if they agreed, the parents said, let's talk. The children might now be 5 years old, 6 years old. Joseph and Mary were probably 10 years old at the time that they were married. The two sets of parents discussed the marriage between their children. They didn't ask their child, would you like to marry little boy over here? No. They had it, the marriage was done by the parents. And once they had agreed, they set up a legal contract. And then Joseph's parents and the other parents would go down to the courthouse. They would visit the gate of the city. And by the way, the gate of the city is the name for the courthouse. The courthouse was always at the gate of the city. And they registered the marriage between the children. And Joseph and Mary were officially espoused. So technically now, after they've been to the courthouse, the dowry was paid, paperwork signed, they were now married. In Luke 1:27, we read this. To a virgin espoused to a man whose name was Joseph of the house of David, and the virgin's name was Mary. Now, after they had made the agreement, Mary lived in her house with her parents. Joseph lived in his house with his parents. They did not intermingle at all. That was prepared for later. Now, the Mosaic law stipulated that death was a punishment for the espoused woman who was unfaithful. Take your Bible and turn to Deuteronomy chapter 22. That is the book of Deuteronomy, chapter 22. And I'm sure that most people, when they had a Christmas story, they never even know about this, and it just goes over their head. So in Deuteronomy, let me get to it. Here we go. 22, and we want to pick it up in verse number 13. If a man take a wife and go in unto her and hate her, and give occasion of speech against her, bring up an evil name upon her, and say, I took this woman, and when I came to her, I found her not a maid or a virgin. Then shall the father of the damsel and the mother take and bring forth the tokens of the damsel's virginity unto the elders of the city in the gate. Let me explain that. On the wedding night, the parents of the bride would furnish a white sheet, brand new. And that would be laid in the marriage bed. And so then when the husband and the wife came together for the first time, a woman, when her virginity is taken, always have some bleeding. And if there was not a blood spot on the sheet, that husband then would say, my wife is not a virgin, and she will be killed. So that's for the token. So now, after the wedding night, that sheet would go to the bride's parents. And they would safeguard that in case the guy start lying. They can say, no, here is the sheet. Verse number 16 now. And the damsel's father shall say unto the elders, I gave my daughter unto this man to wife, and he hates her. And lo, he has given occasion of speech against her, saying, I found not your daughter a maid, and yet these are the tokens of my daughter's virginity. Here's a sheet. And they shall spread the cloth before the elders of the city. I'm sure that you've read that passage many times, and you just, over your head, you didn't know what I'm talking about. And the elders of that city shall take the man and chastise him, and they shall amend him in 100 shekels of silver, and give him to the father of the damsel, because he has brought up an evil name upon a virgin of Israel. He shall be his wife, and she shall be his wife. He may not put her away all his days. Now, but if this thing be true, and the tokens of virginity be not found for the damsel, there's no blood on the sheet, then they shall bring out the damsel or the young woman to the door of her father's house, and the men of her city shall stone her with stones that she die, because she has wrought folly in Israel to play the whore in her father's house. So shall you put away evil from among you. Let's go back now to the story of Mary and Joseph. Can you imagine now if there was a death sentence if you were not a virgin when you married? That Mary, when the angel came in and said, you're going to get pregnant. And she said, but I haven't seen a man. And she was troubled. And the angel said, Don't worry about it. Holy Spirit will do this job. And you're going to get pregnant by the Holy Spirit. Think about Mary now. She's probably about 16, 17 years old. And she's pregnant. How do I tell Joseph that an angel came in to me and said, I'm going to get pregnant? And Joseph was like, oh, really? That's nice. She was scared. Let's go to Matthew now, chapter 1, verse 18. That's Matthew. Now, when you read this story before, most of you have never even thought about the dilemma that Mary was in getting pregnant without a man. In Matthew 1:18, we read this. Now, the birth of Jesus Christ was on this wise, when as his mother Mary was espoused to Joseph, before they came together, she was found with child of the Holy Ghost. Then Joseph, her husband, being a just man, not willing to make her a public example, was minded to put her away privately. Joseph loved Mary, and he said, wow, Mary, she's pregnant. I'm going to put her away privately. I don't want her to be killed. But while he thought on these things, verse 20, behold, the angel of the Lord appeared unto him in a dream, saying, Joseph, you son of David, fear not to take unto you Mary your wife, for that which is conceived in her is of the Holy Ghost. So now you know the story of Mary is much more deeper than you have known prior to this. Let's talk about the wedding now. We could discuss that. A date was set for the wedding feast when an espoused man was financially strong enough to support his wife. As far as the Mosaic law was concerned, he and the fiancée were already married, because he had been previously registered. All weddings were paid for by the father of the groom, and guests were given wedding garments when they arrived at the father's house. Notice now, here it is the father of the bride that gets stuck with the paying for the wedding. In Israel, it was the father of the groom that paid for it. Only the groom knew when he was going to the home of the bride and pick her up. They had a ceremony, they had a, what do you call it, the way they did it was that they were set the day, and it was a 24-hour period. And they thought this was fun. So the groom would simply say, on such and such a day, 24-hour period, I will come and pick you up. But he wouldn't dig for an hour. So the bride would have to sit for 24 hours to be ready to be picked up. Once the groom said, time to go, he would have a wedding party, friends of his. They would have little trumpets and instrument, and they would go in the villages, they'd go down on the streets. They would not go straight to the house of the bride. They would go around and sing and shout, and anyone invited had to join the party going to the wedding, to the bride, or catch it on the way back. You could not go to the father's house directly. The custom was you had to catch it when he was going to or from to pick up the bride. If you missed that, you couldn't get into the wedding. Another thing that they had was that you could not bring your wedding clothes. Here, if you go to a wedding, you dress up, ladies dress up in nice dresses, and men don't dress up, and you come to the wedding. In those days, you came with your street clothes. And at the door of the father's house, he would stand, he would have a stack of robes behind him, and every guest would be checked out and then given a robe and going in. You could not bring your own wedding clothes. Page 2 now. Once the marriage parade arrived at the home of the father stood at the door and handed out special wedding garments to each guest. Guests could not bring their own garments, wedding garments. They were exclusively provided by the father. If you don't know this background here, the 10 virgins, you don't understand the story. Because you try to fit it to an American wedding or a European wedding, and it doesn't fit. Once everyone had gotten dressed, the festivities started with a lavish meal featuring musicians and singers. This was followed by more entertainment, and then the groom and the bride entered the bridal chamber where the marriage was consummated. So, they did not have a marriage ceremony at the wedding. That was done when they were children. So at the wedding itself, they would come, they would have joy, they would eat, do different things. And then a special room had been prepared in that house, the front house. A white sheet had been put down on the bed. And the groom and the bride would walk in, close the door, consummate the marriage, and in the morning, they would show the sheet that there was blood on the sheet, and that would be kept by the parents of the bride in case the groom got crazy and said something else later. Having this as the background now, let's turn to Matthew chapter 25. So a bride would have bridesmaid, and the groom would have men that were with him, just like we have in our weddings today. As Jesus stood on the temple ground, he told a parable about 10 virgins who were waiting to attend the wedding. Since they had to be ready for a particular 24-hour period, they had oil lamps if the festivity took place after the sunset. So we read now Matthew 25:1. Then shall the kingdom of heaven be likened to the 10 virgins. We took their lamps and went forth to meet the bridegroom. The 5 wise virgins brought extra oil if the groom arrived late than expected. Remember, they had to wait for 24 hours. The 5 foolish virgins expected the groom to come quickly and had just enough oil to make their lamps burn for a while. They had made no provision for the delay. Verses 2-4. 5 of them are wise, 5 are foolish. They that were foolish took their lamps, took no oil with them. But the wise took oil in their vessels with their lamps. They had spare oil with them. Now, on the outline here, we said this. The wise virgins refer to those who are prepared for the second coming of Jesus. The foolish virgin revealed the conduct of those who profess to love Jesus, but are not prepared to meet him. In other words, they are not saved. Now, most people in the world, even unsaved, they says, well, I don't hate Jesus. I love Jesus. He's a nice guy. He was a nice guy. But if you're not born again, you cannot come into the kingdom of heaven. In verse 5, we read this here, that while they waited, while the bridegroom tarried, they all slumbered and slept. Figure this now, they have been waiting now for 24 hours, and then finally the night came, they said, well, he's not coming, so we might go to sleep. So they went to sleep. And at midnight, there was a cry made, behold, the bridegroom comes. go out to meet him. Then all those virgins arose and trimmed their lamps. Trimming their lamps, they simply got the thing there, and they pulled it out, get the light burning nice. And the foolish said unto the wise, give us of your oil, for our lamps are gone out. They run out. You know, when it comes time to you to leave this earth, if you're not saved, and you realize, okay, I'm going to die. I'm going to accept Christ now. It's too late. After your body died, you cannot repent. Remember that. You might cry and say, oh God, I'm so stupid. I should have done this. Please save me, Jesus. And he's going to say, no. It's too late. You have to be saved while you still are living on this earth. At death, even an atheist is going to believe. He's going to say, there is a God. I believe now. And then he's going to say, well, that's too late. Too bad. Too little. In verse number 9, but the wise answer saying, not so, lest there be not enough for us and you, but go you rather to them that sell and buy for yourself. They simply said, no, if we give you our oil, it will be too little for us and too little for you. It's not going to work. You have to go and buy it yourself. And while I went to buy, the bridegroom came. They were ready, went in with him to the marriage, and the door was shut. Remember this now, a wedding at the time of Jesus. You had to catch the groom going to pick up the bride, coming back to pick up the bride. You could not go to the house directly. You had to catch the groom going and coming. And the door was shut. Afterward came also the other virgins, saying, Lord, Lord, open for us. But he answered and said, verily I said to you, I know you not. That's the most terrible words that an unsaved person will hear when he dies. And Jesus said, I don't know you. Do you understand that? If you don't accept Christ when you are alive on this earth, once you die, you cannot accept Christ. You cannot say, now I believe. There's a cutoff date. There's a cutoff time. I really want to hammer that home. Today, God loves you. Jesus loves you. But if you're not saved today, and you wait until you have died, and then you said, now I want to be saved, it's going to be over. You can't. There's a cutoff date. It doesn't matter how much you cry. It doesn't matter how much you cry out to Jesus. It's over. It's done. See if I can paint the picture for you. You're going to fly someplace, and there's a time for departure. And you're getting late to the airport. And you're running up to the place where they give you the boarding pass and so on. And you come running up and say, I got a ticket, can I get a boarding pass? And the person that's working there says, no. You see through the window there? That airplane is already taxiing out for takeoff. It's too late. That passenger can cry and says, well, please, can't you stop the airplane? Can't you stop the airplane? I haven't come back. I need to go. They says, no. You're too late. You can't go. Remember that. If you're not saved, and you try to wait and wait and wait. If you die, and then you say, oh, I believe now, they're going to tell you it's too late. Let's turn to the last page. And we're going to read verse number 13 in Matthew 25. Watch therefore, for you know neither the day nor the hour wherein the Son of Man comes. Watch therefore, for you know neither the day nor the hour when the Son of Man comes. I've been saved for many years. And I'm not scared of death. I know that I'm saved. I got my ticket. I'm not scared about the Antichrist coming. I'm not scared Jesus is coming back. It's settled. I'm in. Every one of us that have accepted Christ and been born again, you don't have any fear. You're ready. When Jesus comes, you're ready. Now, you don't want to go out and live like hell, but you want to work for Jesus and do work for God. So when he comes for you, he can say, well, you're a faithful servant. You're not only saved, but you've been faithful. Watch therefore, for you know neither the day nor the hour when the Son of Man comes. I'm thinking of Donald Trump yesterday. He came in an airplane to that city we was at. He got into the car. The limousine, they're going to take him up. And Donald Trump did not know that today you're going to get shot at. He got up there, listened to the song they had. It's a good song written by a Christian. He was going to start speaking, and he was going to do his normal routine when the shot ran out. And that rally never finished. It stopped. Gracefully, prayerfully, thankfully, God had an angel twist his head. He didn't die. But I'm sure that Donald Trump had not been thinking, you know, I'm going to this rally, you know, about 3 minutes into the rally, you know, they're going to shoot at me. He didn't know that. You do not know when you come, times to go. You were not given notice in advance. When it comes, there'll be an angel tapping you on the shoulder and saying, it's time to go, and your body drops. The question is, watch therefore, for you know neither the day nor the hour when the Son of Man comes. In the summary right now, I want you to go with me, to turn with me to Revelation chapter 19. That's Revelation chapter 19. And this is about the wedding feast that will take place in heaven. So we read from 19 and verses up to number 9. And after these things, I heard a great voice of much people in heaven saying, Hallelujah! Salvation and glory and honor and power to the Lord our God. For true and righteous are his judgments. For he has judged the great whore, which did corrupt the earth with the fornication, has avenged the blood of his servants at our hand. And again they said, Alleluia, and the smoke rose up forever and ever. And the 24 elders and the 4 beasts fell down and worshipped God, that sat on the throne saying, Amen, Alleluia. And a voice came out of the throne saying, Praise our God, all your servants, and you that fear him, both small and great. And I heard, as it were, the voice of a great multitude, as the voice of many waters, as the voice of mighty thunderings, saying, Alleluia, for the Lord God omnipotent reigns. Let us be glad and rejoice, and give honor to him, for the marriage of the Lamb is come, and his wife has made herself ready. And to her was granted that she would be arrayed in fine linen, clean and white, for the fine linen is the righteousness of saints. And he said unto me, Right blessed are they which are called unto the marriage supper of the Lamb. And he said unto me, These are the true sayings of God. Here is the good news. You and I in the chapel, we have accepted Christ. We have a seat at the marriage feast of the Lamb. There will be a name on that chair. Have your name on it. And we're going to come. We are in heaven. We have been through the judgment seat of Christ. We got our white robes on. Can you imagine the joy in this huge banquet hall that would seat millions of people? Angels are playing music, and you're being seated. You come in your new robe, and an angel is escorting you and taking you down and say, Here is your seat. And you look down and say, Wow, I made it. I'm here. It's real. I'm getting married to Jesus. Can you imagine the joy? That's yours. That's mine. Jesus is our salvation. If you are not saved, you don't have a reservation. Turn to the book of Acts right now, chapter 4. The book of Acts, the 4th chapter. And we read Acts chapter 4. And we read from verse number 12. Neither is there salvation in any other, for there is none other name under heaven given among men, whereby we must be saved. Neither is there salvation in any other, for there is none other name under heaven given among men, whereby we must be saved. If you're not saved, you cannot come in and say, Father God, Holy Spirit, it has to be under the name of Jesus. You have to repent and ask Him to forgive you. If we now go to Ephesians chapter 2, we learn some more about salvation. That's Ephesians chapter 2, verses 8 through 9. For by grace are you saved, through faith, that not of yourself, it is a gift of God. Not of works, lest any man should boast. We are saved by grace. I am not saved because I've been preaching. I'm not saved because I casted demons out. I've done this, I've done that. I'm saved because I've repented of my sins, received Christ as my Lord and Savior. That is my salvation. And then we go to Romans chapter 10. That's Romans, the 10th chapter. And we're going to pick it up here in Romans chapter 10. And we're going to pick it up in verse number 9. That if you can confess with your mouth the Lord Jesus, and shall believe in your heart that God has raised him from the dead, you shall be saved. For with the heart man believes unto righteousness, and with the mouth confession is made unto salvation. For the scripture says, Whosoever believes on him shall not be ashamed. For there is no difference between a Jew and a Greek, for the same Lord over all is rich unto all that call upon him. For whosoever shall call upon the name of the Lord shall be saved. Here's how simple it is. I'm sure that you've been to weddings, and you've seen them. Man comes in, bride looking gorgeous, and so on. They walk down the aisle. Actually, the man stands up, then she comes down the aisle. And then you have the pastor, whoever is officiating. And he would say to the groom, would you take this woman to be your lawful wedded wife? And she would say, yes. He would then say to the woman, would you take this man to be your lawful wedded husband? And she said, yes. He then says this, upon your confession, I pronounce you husband and wife. A marriage is through the confession of the man and the woman that said, yes, I take this person to be my lawful wedded spouse. Exactly the same way you get saved. You confess with your mouth, I believe Jesus is real. I believe he died for me. I believe he rose on the third day. He paid for my sins. Yes, Jesus, I want you to save me. I want you to come into my life. I want to belong to you. It's a confession. When you make that confession, you repent of your sins, you are saved. Not by water baptism, not by work you do later, but you're saved by that confession. We're going to close with Matthew chapter 7. And I'm going to close negative. Have you thought about that? Matthew chapter 7. And we're going to pick it up from verse number 21. Not everyone that says unto me, Lord, Lord, shall enter the kingdom of heaven, but he that does the will of my Father, which is in heaven. What is the will of the Father? That you repent. You turn from your sins and you repent. Many will say to me in that day, Lord, Lord, have I not prophesied in your name? In your name I cast out devils, and in your name done many wonderful works. It's a lot of people. We had this woman, Sister Teresa. She was a Catholic nun. She gave her whole life to charity. She worked in Calcutta, India. And you know, it was told when she was fit, she was on her deathbed. She simply said this, I'm scared. I don't know Jesus. She never repented of her sins. In a Roman Catholic church, you are not told that you got to repent, you got to ask for forgiveness, you got to take Jesus in. She did all the good work. And I want you to think about this. Unless the last moment before she died, she asked Jesus to save her, she would end up in hell. Can you imagine this? A woman in hell that's given her life to the sick, the lepers, the blind, and she worked with them, set up orphanage, everything else. She gave her life for everything. And she ends up in hell. Can you imagine if that's what did happen to her? That she could say in heaven, I mean in hell, everything I did was for nothing. We should feed the poor. We should help people that are in need. But if you feed the poor, you help them to get this and that, but you never give them Jesus, what have you done for them? Nothing. Without Jesus, it is in vain. And therefore, we read again here what Jesus said, and then I will profess unto them, I never knew you. Depart from me that work iniquity. So my question to the, I know here in the chapel, I know each one here that you have accepted Christ. But I want to ask you that are watching today. I don't know who you are. We have a lot of people watching that you never contacted us, so I don't know you. But have you really asked God for forgiveness? Have you really repented of your sins? Have you really said, Jesus, come on in and save me. Come on in and save me, Jesus. Have you done that? If you've done that, you're saved. But if not, you're lost. When we finish here with the last prayer, the screen will change where you are. Three crosses will come up. And you would hear the voice of Pastor Charles saying, my friend. And he will take you step by step by step to salvation. He will pray with you so you can know for sure today that you are saved. And when you do that, please contact us. I'd like to rejoice with you. And to those of you that are saved, that have been with us for many years, and some of you just come in, my prayer is that you will start praying for this country. Pray against any more assassination of Donald Trump. And let's begin to believe God that we're going to have victory on this election day in America when America turns from evil to good. I pray that you really think this through today and that you spend time in prayer this afternoon. I'm going to ask Michael Burns to come and close.
Dear Heavenly Father, thank you for this day, Lord God. We just ask you to intervene on our behalf, Lord, and watch over us, help us, guide us, direct us, Lord God. Strengthen us in our prayer, strengthen us in everything that we do, Lord God. And we pray for a great revival in us, individuals, that we will revive, have a revival in us, and it'll reach out through America and through the world, Lord God. We just pray and ask you to watch over us. Pray for Donald Trump. Keep him safe and secure in your arms, Lord God. And strengthen him. And help him. In Jesus' name, amen.
Hello there, friend. You might have some questions about Christianity. There are many so-called Christian churches out there. So what makes a person a Christian? How do you get right with God? And how do you know when you die that you'll go to heaven? How exactly does a person get to heaven? Does God have a standard? And if so, what is it? What I'm about to tell you will be the most important information you will ever hear on this earth. And your decision will determine how you spend eternity. As you continue listening, I will explain. The bad news is this. When we are born into this world, we are automatically born with sin. Now you might think of yourself as a good person. After all, you're nice to other people, you give money to charity, and you try to live a good life. However, everyone has sinned and fallen short of God's standard. So it doesn't matter how moral, religious, or philosophical you are, you've broken God's commandments, and that has separated you from God. The Bible says in Romans 3:23, "For all have sinned and come short of the glory of God." Now you might say, "Well, I'm a good person, doesn't that count for something?" Okay, let's take a little test. I'm going to ask you three questions. 1. Have you ever told a lie? 2. Have you ever stolen anything, even something insignificant like a paperclip at work? 3. Have you ever lusted after someone of the opposite sex? Okay, how did you do? Most likely you answered yes to all three questions, which means you just failed the test. You see, these three questions are but three of God's Ten Commandments. Failing just one commandment disqualifies you from getting into heaven and has condemned you to hell. This is why the Bible says in Romans 6:23, "For the wages of sin is death, but the gift of God is eternal life through Jesus Christ our Lord." You see, God knows that we are all guilty of breaking His commandments. That's why He said we've all sinned and fallen short of His standard. But you don't have to be depressed about this. I do have some good news to share with you. In Romans 5:7 through 8, it says, "For scarcely for a righteous man will one die, yet peradventure for a good man some would even dare to die. But God commends His love toward us in that, while we were yet sinners, Christ died for us." You see, God loves you so much that He gave His only begotten Son, Jesus Christ, to pay for the sin in your life. Jesus was more than just a good man. He was God becoming man and walking among us. That is why Jesus died on the cross. He took your place and paid for your sins with His shed blood so that you can have everlasting life. God loves you so much that He sent His own Son to pay a debt He did not owe, because you owe a debt you could not pay. Jesus bridged the gap created by sin between you and God. The Bible says in John 3:16, "For God so loved the world that He gave His only begotten Son, that whosoever believes in Him should not perish, but have everlasting life." You see, there are three places we can exist in this universe: earth, heaven, and hell. So when we die here on earth, we don't just cease to exist. We will step out of our physical bodies and go to one of two places, heaven or hell. God did not send His Son to condemn you, but that through Jesus you might be saved and have eternal life in heaven. God's free gift to you is eternal life through His Son, Jesus Christ. That is why Jesus said, "I am the way, the truth, and the life. No man comes to the Father but by Me." You see, God offers His love to you through Jesus, even though you are a sinner. This unmerited grace is not something you can buy or earn, but a gift from God. As you're listening right now and realize you're a sinner, know that God loves you and wants to save you. All you need to do is repent of your sins and ask God to forgive you. The word repent means to change your direction. You've been running away from God. Now it's time to start running toward Him. The Bible says in Psalms 103:12, "As far as the east is from the west, so far has He removed our transgressions from us." That means if you call out to God and confess your sins, He will forgive you. What Jesus has done in the past for others, He will do for you. If you call out to Him, He will answer you. He won't look down upon you because of your past, and there isn't a sin so great that it can't be forgiven. All He wants for you is to come to Him. He will help anybody who calls out to Him. If you have sin in your life, God still loves you. If you ask God to save you, He will do so. It is important to remember that talking to God can be done anywhere and anytime. You don't have to be in church to talk to God. He will meet you wherever you are. As you're listening to me right now, if you feel a conviction of sin in your life, that is God's Holy Spirit moving upon you. Friend, you need to repent of your sins right now and call out to Jesus. You might not get another chance. The Bible says today is the day of salvation. Friend, you need to make a decision today, one that will affect you for eternity. You have a choice. The road to hell is paved with good intentions, so act today. I would like to lead you in a prayer right now where you can ask Jesus Christ to come into your life and be your personal Lord and Savior. Now you might ask, what you just said, exactly what does that mean? Well, if you want to start anew and have your sins forgiven, Jesus is the way. There is no other way to God than through Jesus. I'm not talking about being religious, I'm talking about having a personal relationship with the God of creation who loves you so much and is just waiting for you to reach out to Him. That is what I mean by asking Jesus to come into your life and save you. Won't you pray with me right now? God, I confess that I am a sinner and that I need to be saved from my sins. Jesus, I ask that you would forgive me of my sins. I turn from them now, and I put my faith in you. Come into my life and be my Lord and Savior. I believe that you paid for my sins on the cross through your shed blood, and that you died for me and rose from the grave. Save me, Jesus. I know I can't save myself. Thank you for saving me and giving me eternal life and a place in heaven with you. Help me to be obedient and to walk with you. In Jesus' name I pray. Amen. If you just prayed with me and asked Jesus to save you, you are now a Christian. You have become born again and are a new creation in God's eyes. The Bible says in Romans 10:13, "For whosoever shall call upon the name of the Lord shall be saved." You see, you're not saved because you might feel saved, but because you have called upon God and He has saved you. Now, as a way to grow closer to Him, the Bible tells you to follow up on your commitment. Spend time with God each day. It doesn't have to be a long period of time. Just develop a daily habit of talking with Him and reading the Bible. Ask God to increase your faith and understanding of the Bible. Also, find a local church where you can worship God and seek fellowship with other Christians to answer your questions and support you. Be sure they use a King James Bible if you live in an English-speaking country, and that the pastor teaches out of the Bible. Plus, don't forget to share your new faith in Jesus with somebody else. After all, if I didn't make this recording to share with you, how would you have heard the good news? Finally, please contact us and tell us about your decision. We will send you some written material that will help you in your new walk with Jesus. This is Charles Torell with European American Evangelistic Crusades. May you grow in grace and in the knowledge of our Lord and Savior Jesus Christ. To Him be glory both now and forever.
You've been listening to the weekly webcast of Pastor John S. Torell. This message was the 68th part in the series, The Gospel of Matthew, and was entitled, The Ten Virgins. The parable of the ten virgins is one of the most familiar stories of the New Testament. The problem is that most Christians are ignorant of Hebrew marriage customs 2 millennia ago. Marriages were arranged and a dowry was paid to the bride's parents once the terms were settled. Years later, the groom set the day of the wedding, and it was up to the bride and the rest of the guests to be ready during that particular 24-hour period. Anyone that failed to join the groom's parade to the bride's home or to the venue afterwards was excluded from the wedding feast. The oil in the parable represents salvation. The ten virgins represent two groups of people. The wise virgins are those who are prepared for the second coming of Jesus. The foolish virgins reveal the conduct of those who profess to love Jesus, but are not prepared to meet Him. The takeaway is that it is impossible to enter heaven without the righteousness of Jesus, let alone take part in the marriage supper of the Lamb. This message is available on CD and DVD. When ordering, ask for sermon number 1971. There are several ways to contact our ministry. You can visit our website at eaec.org. There you can read insightful articles, watch or listen to a sermon broadcast, and explore the online store. The web address once again is eaec.org. If you prefer to write, address your envelope to European American Evangelistic Crusades, Post Office Box 166, Sheridan, California, 95681. That's Post Office Box 166, Sheridan, California, 95681. If you prefer to call us, the number is 916-944-3724. That's 916-944-3724. Resurrection Life of Jesus Church is sponsored by European American Evangelistic Crusades, and this has been a production of EAEC. Thanks for joining us today, and until next time, may God richly bless you as you read your Bible and walk with Him.